behind the first customer you got?
So good question. So I think you spoke about lean.
My wife made sure that my lifestyle habits were not crazy. Okay, and I was, you know, a teacher, right? So most of people like us, you know, we don't have. I'm not addicted to anything. I don't smoke. I drink casually, but I don't smoke. So it was easier for me to manage my lifestyle habits. Okay. Rather, when I had landed in the US, you know, my boss had asked me to change my wardrobe. Okay, so he had asked me to buy a lot of things. Okay, so I did done that. So for me, the lifestyle habits was not the challenge, actually. Okay, it was the risk I was getting my family into. Okay, so making sure that I factor that in my brain every day, and making sure that I don't put them at risk for something that I want to do, okay, was very important for me as a person. And I was planning on that, I would say. So the lifestyle habits, I think, is a very important aspect for most who have expenses above $1,000 a month, which is 50,000 rupees. They have to refactor them, unless you are funded on day one. No matter what, you have to bring down your expenses to 20,000 rupees. How do you do that? Figure out a way. Don't get into entrepreneurship otherwise. Because the risk of not doing that is very high. You would do the same thing with your company. Okay? I forgot the second question.
First customer.
So first, as I said, you know, I had a customer when I started Unicam. So I had already gone, met customers, and I told them I'm going to start something like this. I need your support. And I met 10 of them, 5 of them said yes, and 3 of them gave me, you know, a project within the first 3 months or 4 months. So we started off with the PO in the first 4th month. So I made sure that we had revenues flowing in the first 6 months. And hence I said it's nothing wrong to start a services business, even if you have a product idea. Because getting the right investor to fund your product business takes at least a year or two. Unless you get lucky, okay, which is 1 in 99.
So we spoke about founding team, how to get the first set of few employees. And then fast forward to last year when you actually stepped down as a founding CEO and then hired a professional CEO.
Yeah.
How easy or how difficult was that choice? And when a founder should actually be saying that, okay, it's not my cup of tea, or rather I'll let someone else manage things professionally?
Yeah, so I had been giving up different roles. So when I started Unicam, I was the guy who was sweeping the floor, you know, making sure that I was the receptionist. So then you hire a reception. So at every stage, you give up different roles. Okay, so at some point, I was also running the finance. So between the 4 of us, we had already shared responsibilities, not roles. We were not title hungry. We were making sure that the company runs. So there was a point when we said, now we need specialists for different things. So at that point in time, I questioned myself and the team also that what is it that we are really, really good at as individuals? Because you need to compete in a global market. Okay? If you think you are the greatest CEO on this planet, that means you have that passion and that skill to be the CEO, then you should remain the CEO. Okay? If you think, no, my passion and my skill is actually something else, then you should specialize in that. And no transition is easy. Every transition is tough because you are emotionally connected to a lot of things you do around it. But making sure that you make that transition, you tell yourself that this is important for the company, and you keep the company interests before your personal interests, okay, very important. Okay, again, having an investor who is supporting you through that journey, making sure that, okay, that your process of transition is easier, helps a lot, because your friends and family also help. So no transition is simple. But having that clarity of thought, that what is it that I want to do in the next 5 years? So now I have moved up to become the chairman and the chief scientist. Yeah. So at one point, you have to give up a lot of these roles to people who are specialists in doing that job. You can't think and imagine of doing everything. You know, if you're small, it doesn't matter. Once you have hit a certain scale, then you need to really refactor your roles and responsibilities.
So how easy or difficult was it to find that professional CEO, considering that, you know, in India, we have a very few deep tech products?
Yeah.
So how was that?
So as I said, you know, my investors helped me. Okay. My board members helped me. So we had, even before getting investment in Unicam, I always had high quality board members. I made sure that they were there advising the company. So the network of board members was very critical. So hence, even when in the fifth year of my company, okay, we had good quality board members. and they have been with me for a very long time. So they understand the business and they contribute in the business. So it is not like me hunting for a CEO. It is a team of board members, investors, the community at large, finding the right high quality CEO or whoever you want to hire for the company, because it's a collective responsibility. So I don't think entrepreneurs need to be grossly worried about that, because that's a journey that happens. It's more about continuously focusing on the market and the opportunity. Execution is the second half of it. But US founders are the ones who can see that opportunity early on. So that role and responsibility you've got to play on a continuous basis.
And let the right people.
Yes, let the right people run the show. End of the day, this is a teamwork and they have to do what they're good at.
Sanjay, quick question. You talked about the first customer on your services side, when you reformatted yourself into this product business, especially in the security, where trust and credibility matter a lot.
Right.
How did you get your first customer, and what is it?
So, again, on the product side, when we had the IP with us, when we had the first prototype ready, I started talking to the right folks. So when the defense guys said, maybe after defense, it's the finance. So we were talking to a lot of banks, and my chairman, the then chairman, connected me to the right person in the bank. So I met the chairman of a bank, and then I was pointed to Reserve Bank of India. And then the former deputy governor of RBI, he said maybe this has applications in banking. So then I presented to a few banks, and one of the banks said, we don't mind co-innovating with you and being the first customer. But being a very large bank and we being a very small company, they said we are not going to buy directly from you. So I had to partner with HP, which was a systems integrator. Another extremely important decision from our side. So we partnered with the right SI. They went along with us. We gave up a lot of the initial business to them. But thanks to their help, the collaboration went very well, because we were dealing with large banks, very strategic line of sight technology. And through this effort, we got our first 2 to 3 customers. So it is not, again, DIY. It is not do it yourself. It has to be that ecosystem. You have to find the right partners, convince the partners, and get everybody to work for your objective. That's what we did. And hence, we got the first 3 customers through that process. We didn't make a hell lot of money, but we had the tick mark that large banks working with us, HP is our partner, so on and so forth.
So did the bank introduce you to HP?
Yes, they said, work with these guys. That's it. We are not going to buy directly from you. You're too high a risk for us. So Government of India has those knocks. They will buy only from companies which are 1,000 crore or 500 crores. Now they're changing it, which is good for the country. But 2006-07, that was not the case. And it worked in our advantage as well, because HP took a lot of that front-end effort and helped the innovation happen. So I'm really grateful to some of these very, very large organizations. Mindtree helped us later on. So there were some of these very large organizations. Now TCS is working. So there are these organizations that do help young companies. So you should reach out to them with your product idea, because they already have customers. You don't have to worry about doing the sales. You just have to make sure that you partner with them and strike the right deal.
Yeah,
one question. I work with an Israeli company, so generally they're very tough people to work with. I'm really surprised how you went down to Israel and made a sale over there, especially in the
security. We'll talk off. No, I was part of the Indo-Israel security delegation. So the government of India had picked up Unican. So there were nine of us. The Tatas had some representation. So I already had the 10 people on their side whom I was talking to. So there was food security and cyber security. So through that summit, I made a few connections and friends. And it was a very tough journey. So we got our product tested in one of the finest security testing labs in Israel. Only when they, and it's a very small community, so one person knows, everybody knows there. So only when that person and that organization certified it, that we could go into that market slightly ahead. Okay. But it was not a market for market share perspective. It was a validation market for us. So I won't advise everybody. If you have a high tech, deep tech product, go and get it validated. And if you have something like this, do talk to me. I do have friends and I can help you maneuver that conversation. Okay. But it is not something that you wake up in the morning and do. Unless you think this is going to be extremely strategic for your organization, don't look at markets like Israel. Go to Singapore, go to Japan. Go